Workers in Berks is supported by Southeastern PA Area Labor Federation.
Hi, good evening, and welcome to this episode of Workers in Berks. I'm Stefanie Towles, and this is a live call-in broadcast. I have with me a very special guest today, someone that I'm very glad to call a friend, but someone who I'm eager to hear talk about his position. Jerry Oleksiak is the Pennsylvania Secretary of Labor and Industry, and he is here to talk about the initiatives and goals of the Wolf administration and what is happening in Pennsylvania with regard to labor and industry and jobs and career planning and all the things that are going on our behalf in Harrisburg. So, Jerry, it's good to have you here.
It's good to be here, Stefanie. Thanks for the invite. It's nice to see you, as always, and I'm looking forward to our conversation.
Okay. If anyone is interested in calling in, the number is 610-378-0426. And I'm just going to start with the basics. Can you just explain a little bit for our audience of what exactly the Department of Labor and Industry does?
Sure. The department is one of the cabinet-level agencies in the state. It is one of the larger agencies in Pennsylvania. We have about 4,000 employees, and we have five major areas that we oversee. And what I like about it is that it really affects people directly. We deal with workers' compensation and insurance issues, unemployment compensation, safety and labor management relations, workforce development, and our Office of Vocational Rehabilitation, helping our citizens with disabilities find employment. Mm-hmm. So we're a very active, far-reaching organization, and I love the work, and I'm very proud of the work that we do.
Well, that's a large group of employees. So what are some of the projects specifically? Like, what are some of the things that your staff are actually doing day-to-day?
Well, in each of the, bureaus within the agency, there's a lot going on. In our OVR, Office of Vocational Rehabilitation, for example, one of the programs that we really like that's happening right now is a summer internship program for college students with disabilities, and they're working in different state agencies. And as much as they are learning from us about what happens in public service and in state government, we're learning from them as well, the skills and talents they can bring. Despite in many cases, some real disabilities, they bring their talents and their gifts, and we love seeing the work that they can do. So that's one small piece that we're doing. We're also very involved in the governor's budget proposal, which hopefully will get done on time this year. The governor has the PA Smart proposal, and it's a plan to really create the workforce for the 21st century in Pennsylvania. Part of that, the $50 million that the governor is proposing, would go, 10 of that would go to labor and industry, and we would be able to expand the apprenticeship programs we have, the business partnerships, the next generation partnerships, we're calling them, to help businesses work together in conjunction with us to help them meet their employment needs. That's an important piece that we're looking at right now. And just the day-to-day work of the people in Pennsylvania that are unemployed. Right now, our unemployment rate is the best it's been since 2007. So, you know, people are working in Pennsylvania. But there aren't, not everyone, unfortunately. So people on unemployment compensation, we're responsible for them getting the benefits that they've earned. And, you know, we work very hard at that. We also, you know, nobody wants to be hurt at work, but it does happen. So we oversee the workers' compensation system in Pennsylvania. So there are ongoing things that we're always looking to do better and improve, and then there are initiatives like the summer internship program and the PA Smart proposal. Mm-hmm. And throughout the state, and again here in Berks County, we have a very active Career Links program where we're looking to have people who maybe have lost their work technology has taken their job or it's moved out of the country, for them to go to places where they can get the opportunity to learn new skills or find jobs that meet the skills they have. And so there's a lot that goes on in labor and industry.
And I understand that you have visited our
I visited several of them. I've talked to the folks from Berks County. It was at a different meeting than I didn't get to the Career Center, but I have visited some, and I will get to the one in Berks County. And it's great to see the success stories when you have people who, some people are there working to get their GED. Others are there with, they already have their advanced degrees and they're looking for other employment. Maybe their work has left the country or technology has changed and they need to upgrade their skills. So we're always looking for ways that we can help the citizens of Pennsylvania.
I think we have a home viewer. Home viewer, good evening.
Hello, Steph. This is Jack.
Hi, Jack. How you doing?
I know. I just wanted to say, first of all, I know the state and the federal work kind of like together in certain ways. I don't know if you kind of agree with me in certain ways. But I also wanted to throw in, you know, with the so-called tax cuts that Trump has, which I don't really, you know, like. But I know that the unemployment rate, you know, supposedly looks good now. But the so-called tariffs is something that really kind of scares me because, you know, the gas prices are going up. And, you know, even though the rate looks good now, but my concern is what next year is going to look like and, you know, and maybe even early to, you know, to 2020 is how the job market is going to look. You know, all the people that are unemployed because we have the tariffs, we see the gas prices going up and all that, you know, how is that going to end up, you know, having an effect, especially with our exports? You know, all these other countries are now, you know, putting tariffs on us because of what Trump is doing.
You know, that's a great question, Jack. Thank you.
All right.
It's something that we're constantly monitoring. Unfortunately, we can't control the federal budget. We certainly can't control the decisions of the president when it comes to things like tariffs. But they do have an impact on those of us here in Pennsylvania. And we work closely with the Federal Department of Labor. We work with the Department of Education, several federal level agencies to make sure that we can address those needs when they come up. A lot of what we do is respond to situations when there are impacts of things like the tariffs that you're talking about. We have a rapid response team that will work with employers and employees when they're in danger of plant closures. We have job training programs, again, through our apprenticeship programs and our workforce development, to help people who are caught in those situations to find meaningful employment. It's difficult to predict what's going to happen, and that's part of what has us constantly watching and seeing what we can do to respond to the needs of our population here in Pennsylvania.
Are there any industries in Pennsylvania that are particularly vulnerable to what we've heard unrolling so far, or is it hard to...
All of our industries are vulnerable to it. We've had some issues recently with the dairy industry in Pennsylvania where... some contracts were canceled for our dairy farmers, and we've had to work with the Department of Agriculture to help those dairy farmers find another market.
Were those Canadian?
Some of it was related to that. Some was related to other trade issues.
Oh, okay.
And some was related to production issues. So that there are no easy answers and no easy solutions to these issues. One of the things that forestry and agriculture is a huge industry in Pennsylvania, so we are watching tariffs related to that, and of course, steel, coal. They do have impacts on everyday lives, everyday people. A lot of times we think of, well, this tariff is going to help American jobs. Well, sometimes it does, but it often will cause plants to they can't compete when the tariffs are that high, and it will cost people jobs. So we watch that very closely, and then respond in ways that can help those citizens.
With the way that things are changing so rapidly at the federal level, does the Labor Department, the National Labor Department, do they give you guys insight, directives,
sure,
as to which way things are headed? Do you guys get a head start?
Not usually a head start, but we do work closely with them. In fact, our budget at the Department of Labor and Industry, most of our money is federal money. So it's money that's earmarked toward programs that we oversee, workforce development, unemployment, workers' compensation. All these programs are funded with, to a large degree, federal dollars. Only about 7 or 8% of our budget comes from state dollars. So we always have to, you know, we're happy to have those funds, but we have to also be aware that there are a lot of strings attached, and we have to make sure that we follow all the rules and do the things that we need to do to make sure that that money is used properly. And we're very conscious of that. We do that. Mm-hmm. But there, as far as a heads up, it doesn't really happen like that. If we could get heads up, we'd be playing the stock market regularly. And it doesn't work like that, unfortunately.
Well, Pennsylvania has, like you said, has a low unemployment rate right now. I know that there are a lot of people who aren't working up to the rate that they expect to. But what industries or what fields do you see as being good ones for Pennsylvania residents to go into? I have a daughter who's a junior in college.
Well, the technology is really the a growing area. It's been growing. It continues to grow. But what we're also finding is that it's not like when I entered the workforce or you did, and we kind of knew what we wanted to do, and we, you know, we went to school and got that training, and off we went, and that's what we did. What's really important is that people have to be adaptable and flexible, and be ready for opportunities when they arise. And that's one of the things I like about the work we do at Labor and Industry. When situations change, either personally for people or industries change or needs in industries change, we can be there to help people with retraining, to help redirect them into growing occupations. Mm-hmm. So, you know, we do that all the time. That's part of our core mission.
Okay. And you earlier had mentioned an apprenticeship program. Mm-hmm. And talked about the work that's happening, again, for those people that are just at the start of their career. Mm-hmm. Can you elaborate a little bit on that? What's that
sure.
like?
Sure. About 2 years ago, the governor created the ATO, the acronyms we have, the Apprenticeship and Training Office. And since that time, we've added about 15,000 apprentices in Pennsylvania, over 700 new apprenticeship programs. We have a goal of doubling the number of apprenticeships that we have in the state, and we're really excited about the opportunities that provides people. When the average salary in Pennsylvania, when people get through an apprenticeship program, is about $60,000.
So are you talking about the traditional building
some
trades?
Of it, building trades, some of it is that, but we're also looking to expand into more non-traditional apprenticeship programs, early childhood, biotech, cybersecurity. There's a lot of things that that we know are the jobs of the future. And people are responding. We hope that with that PA Smart initiative, that if we get the $10 million in the budget, seven of that would go toward expanding those apprenticeship programs. Mm-hmm. and looking into those non-traditional programs, doing pre-apprenticeship programs, making sure that young men and women are ready for apprenticeship training programs.
So is that getting into the high school age student?
Or high school, middle school, wherever we can.
All right.
And working with some of our CTCs, the Career and Technical Centers. So there's a lot of opportunities. It's not about as important as a four-year degree can be, and certainly that's the route that I know you and I went. It's not for everyone. And there are real good-paying jobs, solid middle-class jobs that are out there for people who don't have a college degree or don't need a college degree but can learn skills like the traditional building trades and then the more non-traditional apprenticeships that we're hoping to create as well.
That sounds really, really good as we're looking forward. One of the things that people talk about is where the opportunities are. Mm-hmm. Now, I saw that in the governor's budget proposal, he's looking to expand the money in the career centers, the career and technical training centers.
Right.
Can you talk a little bit about where that goes? Or I don't know how
well,
much
some of that money
give,
is through a different department, the Department of Education.
Okay.
Would oversee some of that. But we do work closely with the Department of Education in programs like the apprenticeship program. We also have a program that we're working with PDE in right now, the Teacher in the Workplace. So There are teachers who are connected to different businesses in their communities, learning what the needs of those businesses are, how they can adjust and adapt their curriculums in school to help students understand what the needs of business are. So we're excited about that as well. It's again a whole range of opportunities that we're looking to provide to our citizens in Pennsylvania.
Okay, well that's all good. So we've talked about young people and people that are entering the workforce. For people who are seeking to change careers or looking to make a change, you mentioned that some of the things that are programs that you oversee are helping people to do that. How does one go about that if you're interested in looking in a different field?
Well, the Career Links is a great place to go. There are 60 different centers across the state where people can go and see what, based on the skills they have, see what's available, and not just in their own communities, but throughout the state, or if they are interested in jobs in their communities and they don't have those skills, what skills do they need? And the job, the career centers is a place where they can learn those skills.
Mm-hmm.
So I'm always impressed when I visit the career centers and I see people who, I've said this before, they're, you know, in this classroom they're working on their GED and they may be early 20s, and over here is a class full of veterans who are looking to use the skills they have to get back into the workplace. And then here's a whole classroom full of people who are in the situation we just talked about, where they have been in the workforce for a while and things have changed and they're learning skills that will help them stay in the workforce.
Mm-hmm.
So they're great opportunities for folks.
That's great.
Mm-hmm.
So, one of the things that you talked about in the governor's program is the SMART.
PA SMART proposal.
PA right. SMART.
Mm-hmm.
Can you just explain again how that works in building toward all the areas that you talked
sure.
about?
Sure. Well, some of those funds would go toward, for the Department of Education, for STEM training, which I know you're very familiar with, science, technology, engineering, and math.
And some people like to call it STEAM, and add in
put
arts.
The arts, I know,
yes.
I know. And I'm that's fine with me. I'm a liberal arts guy, so I understand that. But the STEM programs would get students ready for those jobs that we talked about in the future. And, an emphasis on computer literacy and engineering work and careers in math, or where math is really very important. The funds that would go toward labor and industry would be used towards those apprenticeship programs that we talked about.
Mm-hmm.
And again, it's not those traditional ones of building trades, although they are important and will continue to be supported. But it is other non-traditional areas where there will be needs that we see in the future. And we want to get people ready not for the jobs of today, but for the
jobs
of tomorrow. Build a 21st century workforce and build a middle class. We want to have a strong middle class workforce where people can have family sustaining jobs, and that's a challenge. That's a challenge now, and we are doing what we can in the department to help people meet that challenge.
Do we see a lot of change in the population, the working age population here in Pennsylvania?
Well,
is it pretty steady, or have there been?
It's getting older, and people my age are starting to retire. And there are not just people without jobs, but there are jobs without people. And it's important that as that workforce ages and people are entering the workforce, that they are getting the skills they need to fill those jobs and to find new ones, create new ones. So it's a constant, we're constantly watching and constantly seeing what do we need to do, how can we best respond to those needs. So it is a changing demographic.
Are we doing anything to recruit people to our state, or how do we market this Pennsylvania market?
We do, and again, that's a different department.
Oh, okay.
But that's fine. No, there's also a lot we do to keep the whole brain drain thing. We want to keep Pennsylvania as great technical centers and colleges and universities, and we want those people to stay in Pennsylvania. and to keep their talents and skills here to fill those jobs that that are going unfilled in some places. And to understand that it is, as we've said before, it's not just about those four-year programs, but it's about other skills that you can learn through other means that will, again, create those family-sustaining middle-class jobs that we need. Mm-hmm. And it's not just about having the jobs available, as important as that is, but one of the things that I had the opportunity to be a part of was the governor's middle-class task force. And it was a group of business, industry, education, higher education folks, some cabinet members that toured around the state. We went to six or seven different areas around the state to hear from people that were part of the group to see what they need, what we can do as a state to help people get into the middle class.
I hadn't heard about that task force. What are some of the things that came out of that?
Well, some of it has been worked into the governor's budget, like the PA Smart proposal and some other things, and more money for public education and infrastructure. One of the things that we learned is that, and for those of us who are have a middle class income and are used to things being a certain way, you forget that there are people that, they struggle with health care, they struggle with child care, they struggle with transportation. They're taking care of several generations in their family at the same time, so they need the kind of support that that will allow them the opportunity to get the skills they need to go to the career centers and the career links and to get to jobs that are going to work for them and their families. So there are a lot of barriers that we as a state need to address to help people. Things as simple as public transportation, to help to make sure that people can get back and forth to their jobs. So, a lot of what we learned has been worked into the governor's budget proposal.
I like that concept. I wasn't that familiar with the fact that the task force had been there. I'm really glad to hear about it. And it sounds like there's a lot more work to be done.
There is. There's always work to be done, as you know, Steph. There's always work to be done.
So are there any particular projects coming up in the immediate future, or is it just, do you kind of need to wait until you get this budget finalized and
well,
know what you're
we'll
working
hopefully
with?
We'll have some new money in the budget that we can put to the initiatives we've talked about. There's always things that we're looking at to better do the job that we do. Whether it's upgrading our technology in our unemployment compensation call centers and in our the services that we provide to people through those centers, to looking at what we can do through our workers' compensation system to improve the process, to make sure that the interests of the injured workers are protected, the interest of the businesses are protected, insurance companies. There's a balance that we have to find to making sure that the system works properly, and that's an ongoing process.
And speaking of balance, we have a home viewer, but home viewer, we have 2 minutes. So if there's something that you can say very quickly, I'm interested to hear your comments, but we only have a minute or two.
Okay.
Go ahead.
You might have answered the question. I was going to ask what is the greatest cost that employers have that L&I gets involved with? Is it and do they help them defer some of these costs? Is it workers, in fact, workers' comp?
It may be that we don't get into anything where we help defray cost for businesses. We do work with. To make sure that the system works the way it should. There are various other branches of the state government, whether it's our Department of Community and Economic Development, particularly that does work like that. One of the things that we do get involved in, things like the Amazon, potential of Amazon coming to Pennsylvania. Pennsylvania is one of only the only state in the country that has two finalists in the 20 cities that are finalists in Amazon relocating. And we've worked with the Department of Community and Economic Development and doing what we can to help attract new businesses to Pennsylvania. Our goal is to make sure the workforce is ready for those companies when they come.
Would the Department of Community, Community and Economic Development maybe be able to help answer the caller's question more directly, though, if he
Possibly.
Wanted more details?
You could reach out to them.
So
yes.
I encourage you to reach out to them. And I'm sorry, we are totally out of time.
I can't believe it went that quickly.
But Jerry, thank you so much for coming.
Thank you.
It was great to have you on.
It's good to see you.
This has been a episode of Workers in Berks for the Berks County Labor Association, and we will be back here again next month. Thank you.
Workers in Berks is supported by Southeastern PA Area Labor Federation.